Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my honor and delight to introduce our speaker tonight. Our speaker tonight is Joel Salatin. He is a full-time farmer in Virginia's Shenandoah Valley and a speaker on sustainability and food policy. I actually had the chance to meet Joel a couple years ago when we went to his farm in Virginia to film. He's in the film Poverty, Inc., actually. And he had written a book called Everything I Want to Do Is Illegal. And it's a great book. I think we're having book signings afterwards. It's a great book. And, you know, one of the things they say is, like, you know, we need to protect our farmers from competition from the developing world. And so that's why we need tariffs. And I read this farmer who says, well, actually, all those tariffs don't help me either. They're not really protecting me. It's creating all these regulations. It makes it hard for me, an entrepreneur, to compete. So we went down and we visited his beautiful farm, and we have the most beautiful pig footage you've ever seen. So we're going to sell that pig footage. If you make any documentary filmmakers out there, we've got some good stuff. And one of the things that's interesting about Joel is I discovered some of the things reading, and you know, he's an organic farmer. He's an alternative farmer. And so you think, well, okay, he obviously must not be making very much money and must not be doing very, very well for himself. So I looked, and so I know some things. I'm going to shock him a little bit. But the average cow days per acre, write that down, the average cow days per acre in Augusta County where he farms are 80 cow days per acre, and he does 400 cow days per acre. All right? The average income from an acre in his county is $1,000, and he does $3,000. So it's very interesting because some people say, who's the crazy organic farmer, as he's going to the bank? So he describes his occupation as, quote, mob stocking, herbivorous solar conversion, lignified carbon sequestration, fertilization, end quote. Okay? And he speaks a lot about how he built this business. He's actually a third-generation farmer. He returned full-time to the farm in 1982 and has continued refining his parents' ideas. His farm now serves more than 6,000 families, 10 retail outlets, and 50 restaurants through on-farm sales and metropolitan buying clubs. He produces what is called salad bar beef, and I'll let him talk a little about grass-fed beef here in a bit. Pastured poultry, egg mobile eggs, pig-a-rator pork, forage-based rabbits, pastured turkey, and forestry products using relationship marketing. The farm's name is Polyface, meaning the farm of many faces, and it has been featured in the Smithsonian Magazine, in National Geographic, in Gourmet, and on countless other radio, television, and print media. Profiled in the Lives of the 21st Century series with Peter Jennings on ABC World News, his after-broadcast chat room fielded more hits than any other segment to date. It has achieved an iconic status as the grass farm, featured in New York Times bestseller Omnivore's Dilemma by writer Michael Pollan. And he's also in the documentary Food, Inc. as well. He's the author of 9 books. His 10th book is coming out. He writes extensively in magazines such as The Stockman Grass Farmer, Acres USA, American Agriculturist. And he describes himself, and I also want to say, in addition to being a farmer, he also he travels about 100 to 120 days a year giving speeches. So we're delighted that we were able to fit us into your schedule and have you here at Acton University. So I'd like to invite Joel to the stage, and I'll describe him. This is how he describes himself, and it is a quote. He is a Christian. He says, "I am a Christian libertarian environmentalist lunatic farmer." Mr. Joel Salatin.
Thank you, Mark. Left out one piece of that: a Christian libertarian environmentalist capitalist lunatic farmer. That really gets them. It's a really honor to be with you this evening. I just feel like I'm at home here. With all of you, and it's just such a pleasure to be able to share with you and visit here this evening. I will say some things that you will be wildly excited about and some things that you may have to go home and cogitate about, and that's okay. I am a bridge builder. I have been asked to run for political office by the Democrats, the Republicans, the Greens, the Socialists, the Libertarians, and the Constitutional Party. So I figure if everybody wants you that much, you must be saying, I can always irritate everybody and I can always give somebody something to be happy about. So I grew up in this really eclectic home where during the 60s and the beginning of the, the hippie movement, the beaded, braless, bearded revolution, all of our farm friends, and my dad was an economist, and he came to this whole, kind of organic, and I can't use the word organic, that's illegal, so you gotta have a license to use the word organic. It's now been co-opted by the government. So I have to use other things, ecological or whatever. But you know what I mean, it's one of those organic, those weird things. So our family completely, my grandfather was a charter subscriber to Rodale's Organic Gardening and Farming magazine in 1949 when it came out, had a compost pile and all that. My dad got that from him, I got it from dad. So I grew up in this very eclectic home. My mom was the first physical education teacher, professor at Bob Jones College, okay? When it was in Cleveland, Tennessee, before it moved to Greenville, South Carolina. So here we are in this extremely religious right, fundamentalist home, and all of our farm friends are smoking marijuana and come around, a bunch of, hippies, and we go to church on Sunday, and there's a straight lace, and so I lived in this very interesting world, and it didn't really hit me until I was a senior at Bob Jones University. And a campus leader, I was in all the, I was president of different clubs and different things. And I'm a senior, and I open up the magazine that we put out as a university called Faith of the Family. And here I see Dr. Bob Jr., the chancellor of the university. There's an article, the big front page article in the Slick magazine is about the food fads, food cults. And I see where he's going, and about midway through, I read, if you set foot inside of a health food store, you've just joined a food cult. And I'm, kind of discreetly putting around, I'm not sure about this. You can be shipped for this kind of thing. And that was an epiphany. That was a big deal for me because that really showed the tension in the Christian community toward this. Let's fast forward to a few years back. I get invited to speak at UC Berkeley. I don't know how many Bob Jones graduates have been invited to speak at UC Berkeley. But I go to UC Berkeley, and I do my slide program, and I do, I'm an absolute creationist, 6 days, the Bible's real, sanctity of life, do a whole thing at UC Berkeley, get done, and the students erupt in a standing ovation. We go outside, we're done, it's dark. The two professors that invited me, as soon as we're outside of the room, and all the books are signed, and all the hands are shook, and all that stuff, they spin me around in front of a street light and say, we've got a confession to make. Now, I'm not a Roman Catholic, so that can mean different things to different people. But I thought, oh, this will be interesting. I got a confession to make. I said, okay, so what's the deal? And they said, we were scared to death for you. I said, why? I said, because we knew some of the things you were going to say. And at this campus, we've refined the art of hissing speakers when we disagreed with something. And combined, the two of them have been there for 30 years, and they said, we have never in our history heard a speaker use the word of God, use God, the term God, reverently. Now, if you want to use it profanely, that's fine. I mean, that's cool. That's everybody loves that, But if you use it reverently, you get hissed. This was developed during the Vietnam protest era, okay? Speakers come, and the students, if the speaker said something they didn't like, they would show their, this is very mature congeniality on the liberal left, right? Of hissing, the speaker, like a snake. So this is the first time in 30 years we have ever heard a speaker come to campus and use the word God reverently and not be hissed. That struck me. Because suddenly I realized the evangelistic and cultural equity that the Christian community has lost by letting creation stewardship be co-opted by creation worshipers instead of creator worshipers. We doing okay, Mike? Good. Already got applause in the first 5 minutes. That's good. That's a good sign. That's a good sign. We're both scared to death of what's going to happen here. You've got to understand, everybody, that most of my life is spent with these organic tree hugger, you know, cosmic Gaia things. So it's refreshing to be with you, but I'm going to bring a challenge. You see, a lot of us in the faith community don't appreciate that when we have trouble expressing the obvious hypocrisy of hugging a tree or saving a baby whale, and yet being completely in favor of ripping thinking, hearing, forming human babies, wiggling from the womb, and that's fine. If you're like me, I can't even wrap my head around that, right? I mean, we can't even say it, okay? To the environmental community, a Christian who goes to a Sanctity of Life rally and stops off for Happy Meals on the way is just as hypocritical. Whoa, it's a big deal. And so, I would like us to look at this. All of us can share stories of liberal hypocrisy. They're all out of the place. But what about ours? You know, if you go to your local fellowship group, your church, I don't like to use the church, but we're the church. We're the church on the way to meet. We don't go to church. We are the church. You know, this is this segregated thinking we have in our Greco-Roman Western linear reductionist systematized fragmentized thinking. But when we go to that place, if we're going to have a potluck, covered dish dinner, and you dare to question, shouldn't we use paper plates rather than styrofoam? Or better yet, go down to the Salvation Army and buy a bunch of cheap thrift store plates and wash them at the end. You can't even have that conversation because if you dare to ask the question, you're branded some commie, pinko, liberal, tree hunger, Democrat, you know, weird environmentalist wacko, right? Here's my proposition. I want to propose that all of creation is an object lesson of spiritual truth. That's what it's here for. That's what the physical world is here for. And if it's according to the Westminster Catechism, which I tend to agree with, that the end of the whole duty of man is to bring glory to God and live with him forever, how do we inculcate bringing glory to God into our visceral physical lives? You see, you know, we're products of this St. Augustinian duality, unfortunately, that spirit is good and physical is evil. And I would suggest that physical is an object lesson of spiritual reality. We use the word bring glory to God. We use that as some, you know, very, you know, spiritual thing. And we don't use the word glory in many contexts except glory to God. But, you know, the Bible doesn't segregate glory to just a divine thing. It talks about the glory of old men is their gray hair or no hair. The glory of, you know, women is their long hair. The glory of young men is their strength. The glory of nations, it talks about the glory of things celestial and the things terrestrial. And the word glory is used biblically in all sorts of very physical contexts. So what does the word glory mean? The glory of God, the glory of something. I would suggest that the word is really not some sort of real, you know, high academic spiritual word. It's a very specific word that speaks to honoring the distinctiveness of something. What is it that makes it unique? When we bring glory to God, what we're bringing glory to is His unique divinity, His character attributes that we don't have. And so when the Bible speaks of the importance of the glory of things terrestrial, the glory of things celestial, the glory of young men, old men, women, and animals, and all these things, it's simply using the word to honor and respect the distinctive uniqueness of individuals, so that we honor and respect their individual creation, their specialness. And so on our farm, we dare to ask the question, does it matter? Does God care if we honor the pigness of the pig? The tomatoness of the tomato? Because you see, it's in how we honor the least of these and respect their specific, distinctive, unique character in life. It's how we do the least of these that creates an object lesson for our children and our neighbors of how we're going to honor and respect the glory of God or other people or other cultures. See, we live in a culture that views life as fundamentally mechanical and not biological. The only question is, can we grow pigs fatter, faster, bigger, cheaper? We all know that that's not very sacred. I mean, the average NFL football player is dead at 57. The reason is because your neck is bigger than your head. You're a freak of nature, and nature weeds you out. And so, what we're trying to do here when we ask, does it matter? Does God care if we respect and honor the pigness of the pig? We believe that that is the ethical moral framework on which we honor the Maryness of Mary, the Tomness of Tom, and the Arachness of Arachnans, or whatever they are. Afghanistan's, okay? Or Protestants, or Catholics, or whatever. It's that moral framework. And when we view life as fundamentally mechanical, then it can be manipulated however cleverly hubris can imagine to manipulate it. And we are clever beings. We've got a big brain and opposing thumbs. We've got mechanical and intellectual ability that we can bring to bear on our planet. And we can bring that to bear in ways that are so creative and innovative that we can overrun our ability to spiritually, physically, mentally, or ecologically, or emotionally metabolize what we've just innovated. My dad used to call this overrunning our headlights. You know, this is the problem in the movie Jurassic Park. I think there's a fourth one out now, if I'm not mistaken. Jurassic Park, the initial one. I've never seen the other three. But the initial one, if you remember, the critical question in there was, you have this, you know, the scientist that's euphoric over what he's created, you know, these, and he's got these raptors and they're, of course, eating cars and people and beginning to destroy civilization as we know it. He's just euphoric over his contributions to technology and innovation. And the journalist gets in his face and he says, "But sir, just because we can, should we?" That's a pregnant question. That is a pregnant question. And one that we need to ask every day. Just because we can fly flowers from Peruvian boutiques in air freighted, in refrigerated jets to San Francisco boutiques, should we? And I'll talk about GMOs and things like that a little bit later. But just because we can, should we? So let me ask you this. Has this conversation happened in your house? So children, we're going to go out to a farm and get chickens and buy chickens that express their chickenness out on a pasture in a field with fresh air, sunshine, and exercise, because that glorifies the chickenness of the chicken. And it is in glorifying the chicken of the chicken and having that for Sunday dinner to create the specialness of the chicken that we practice what it means to bring glory to God. What is His uniqueness, children, and how can we participate in bringing honor to His attributes? That's an interesting conversation. You know, what if Dan Cathy, the owner of Chick-fil-A, During the brouhaha of their marriage deal, one man, one woman, had followed that up with another press conference and told the world, not only do we believe in the Judeo-Christian biblical mandate of one man, one woman marriage, we also so much believe in the sanctity of life and the reverence of creation that we're going to begin sourcing our chickens from farms that have them on pasture where the chickens can express their chickenness. What would that have done to the conversation? Do you agree that that would have fundamentally turned all sorts of things on their head? What? A Christian being interested in animal welfare? This does not compute. This does not compute, you know. What this mechanical view toward life has led us down the path, it led us down the path, for example, to mad cow. You know, the U.S. duh, I call it the U.S. duh. We've got all sorts of duhs in the federal government. U.S. duh, F duh, you know. Does all this laughter add to my time? I can't talk when all these people are laughing. I'm terribly afraid I'm not going to get everything said I want to say. So here's the deal. The U.S. duh, because life is fundamentally mechanical, said, you know, a cow is just inanimate piles of protoplasmic structure that we can manipulate however cleverly hubris can arrange to manipulate it. And I would suggest that a culture that views its life that way will view its citizens the same way. And other cultures the same way. Whoa. See, it does matter. This is not some esoteric academic religious focus group here. This is real life. And so they came to us and said, we'll take you to free steak dinners if you'll come and learn this new scientific way of brewing cows. So we go, and the meeting is about feeding dead cows to cows. We grind them up, and we feed them back to cows. And woo, look, you know, they grow faster and fatter and bigger and cheaper. And we say, wait a minute, let's look around the planet and see if there is a God-ordered pattern in which herbivores, I mean, a cow is an herbivore. Are you with me? You know, when we have visitors to the farm, we do a lot of school tours. Kindergarten class comes, you know. Kids, what do you call an animal that eats only plants? Herbivore. What do you call an animal that eats only meat? Carnivore, like a lion. What if it eats both? And the smartest one says, omnivore. We're standing there in the field with cows. Okay, so I ask this question, I prep them, and then I turn around, I point to them, I say, so what are those? Cows? No. Herbivores. Okay? Then, children, can you tell me why the most academic, PhD, credentialed, expert people in our society for 30 years told us to feed them meat? And the kids go, ew, yeah, that's crazy, that's stupid. You know, those kids would be a better administrator of the U.S. duh than who's up there. Of course, if it were up to me, there wouldn't even be a U.S. duh. I mean, no federal agency has ever been more successful at eliminating its clientele. When it was started, we had 40 million farmers. Today, we're down to 2. There are more employees at the U.S. duh than farmers. And the budget at the U.S. duh is bigger than the entire farm gate value of all the commodities produced in the U.S. It's crazy. All right, that's just a side note. You got that for free. Okay. But they told us to do this, all right? So we looked around, and we could not see a template in which this occurred, so we didn't do it. Well, guess what? We were branded by the intellectual, commercial, industrial, feed the world community as Luddites, barbarians. What do you want to do? Go back to, you know, hoop skirts, hearth cooking, and washboards, you know, as romantic as that may sound to somebody that's never done it. Backwards, barbarian, you know, people. 30 years later, there's this sudden big global oops, maybe we shouldn't ought have done that, with bovine spongiform encephalopathy. Now, if you learn to say that fast, you sound really intellectual. Bovine instead of mad cow. You know, you sound, I mean, it's like kind of like the names in the Old Testament. You don't have to say them right. Just learn to say them fast and you'll be okay. But see, that brings me to the second big point of spiritual object lesson is that God is a God of order. Genesis starts from out of the chaos came order. And one of the things that the faith community has to offer our culture is marriages and families and businesses and lifestyle of order. The way nature works has pattern. So how does ecology work? How does this planet work? All right, well, there's a sun up there, S-U-N, also an S-O-N. Well, he's everywhere, but S-U-N, he's up there. Okay, the sun is beaming down energy to us. And this energy is being, you know, these sunbeams, these esoteric sunbeams that you can't, you know, catch, they're converted by photosynthetic activity into fungible, tradable, weighable physical evidence called biomass. Vegetation, trees, leaves, grass, okay? And the most efficacious of all of these types of plants, the most efficient one is grass. It's not trees, it's not bushes, it's grass. In the echelon, it's grass is the highest, then bushes, and then trees. So if you really want to catch sunlight, you want prairie, you want grass. Okay? Now, I'm not saying we cut all the trees, but this is the way it is. This is why all the deep soils in the world are made under prairies. They're not made under forests, they're made under prairies, okay? But this grass grows in a sigmoid curve, an S curve, okay? Starts kind of slow, then it grows real fast, and then it kind of dies down. I call this diaper grass, teenage grass, nursing home grass. So the reason there are herbivores around the planet, from alpacas and guinea pigs to wildebeests and zebras and bison and caribou, and all right, the reason for all of these herbivores is because this grass, this forage, grows in a sigmoid curve, and God wants it to stop at senescence and not go clear past nursing home and die. He wants it to be pruned like a viticulturalist would prune a vineyard or an orchardist would prune an apple tree, to be pruned back to start this fast metabolic growth curve. That's why there are animals, that's why there are herbivores throughout the world, and the herbivores are the foundation of the ecological system. And so if we're going to build soil, we do it with perennials, not annuals. And what does our country subsidize? Only annuals, not perennials. I'm not asking for please, not perennial subsidies. Just let's not have any subsidies. And so soil is built with animals, perennials, and predation. Fire, human, and animal predation. That is the way this pruning, this restart, the biomass accumulation restart button actually works. And so on our farm, what we do is we move the cows, the herbivores. We don't have buffalo. We don't have fire. If you start a fire, the fire department comes and puts it out. So what we do is we're mimicking the pattern is animal movement. You know, we live in a time now in our sophisticated techno-glitzy culture when it's assumed that animals don't have to move. But one of the foundational patterns in nature is animals move. Okay? So on our farm, we take some very simple ideas from nature. You know, they're pretty from God's design. There are some very basic principles. One is animals move. Why is that so hard to get? One of the reasons that they move is because they are the great fertility democratizer. How is nature going to move? And I'm sorry if I use nature and that offends you. God's design, I mean, I'm used to using nature because I'm normally not in faith areas, so just pardon me on that. But the way this works is that you've got gravitational movement of all this solar collected biomass and mineral and energy that the plants are creating here. The gravitational pull moves the mineral and the biomass downhill into fertile valleys. Well, how are you going to get that back up on the hills and not just continue to drain the fertility off of the hills? Animals go down into fertile valleys and eat, and because there's predation, they want to get on a high spot so they can look out and see who's going to come and get them. So they walk back up on top of the hill to ruminate and poop, okay? And that moves the mineral and the fertility from the rich valley where it gravitationally moved and move it back up on the top of the hill. So animals are God's way to create egalitarian opportunity, equal opportunity soil development throughout the planet. And we live in a time where the sophisticated conventional wisdom is we don't need animals. In fact, we can segregate animals and just replicate what comes out of their back end from petroleum-based something in a bag, so that we don't need living things to go through their cycle of life and decompose to die to make other living things. It's one of the greatest civilizational problems of chemical fertilization is that somehow we can take life away from the life, death, decomposition, regeneration, life, death, decomposition, regeneration. So these animals are depositing this wonderful manure around and reproducing after their kind. Let's just talk about another spiritual truth here. Here's the idea. What does a food and farming system look like that exemplifies these deep biblical truths that we all hold dear? You know, one of them is, I think we would all agree here in this room, that we believe in a whosoever will salvation, right? You know, it's not exclusive. It's exclusive to the ones who accept Christ, but it's not exclusive to ethnicity. It's not exclusive to, you know, who your parents were. It's not exclusive to a socioeconomic status. It's a completely whosoever will deal, John 3:16. So I would suggest that a farm that exhibits a whosoever will kind of persona would be a farm model that's easy to enter and exit. One of the reasons the average American farmer is now 60 years old is because when the capitalization hurdles to entry are so high that young people can't get in, if young people can't get in, old people can't get out. Okay? So on our farm, we've developed mobile infrastructure, modular infrastructure, and a management-intensive system. You got those three M's, all you good preachers out there. It's all nice, you know. Mobile, modular, and management-intensive. That replaces capital-intensive infrastructure, pharmaceuticals, and chemicals. And so we have replaced those things. And the result is that mobile, modular, and management intensive allows a young person to get in on a shoestring. Look, if you're going to grow a chicken for Tyson, the first thing you've got to build is a $500,000 barn to house 500,000 chickens in. If you want to start with a mobile, modular, management intensive system like we use, you can start on a couple $100 in your backyard. And you can build your modules and scale as it goes up. It's a very easy way to enter and exit. So it's a whosoever will thing. Well, let's go to the other end of the spectrum. That's production. Let's go to the other end of the spectrum and talk about a food desert. You familiar with food deserts? It's one of the you know, biggest issues of the foodie, the social justice groups. What's the answer to the food desert? I would suggest a whosoever will participatory mentality. What does he mean by that? What I mean is, instead of having a government agency or welfare or food bank creating additional dependency in those areas. Most food deserts are in kind of rundown parts of town where there's a lot of empty vacant lots around. Well, if some enterprising young person there, yep, the single mom of four, yep, I'm talking about her, wants to take a vacant lot, put a garden in it, have some chickens and rabbits in there, and start making quiche or pot pies or heavy stews in her tenement kitchen and selling them in the neighborhood, suddenly you have food security from the bottom up embedded in the social structure and in the landscape of the community. But if somebody dared to be so innovative, within 5 minutes, they'd have 10 knocks on the door, first from the building inspector, then the zoning administrator, then the food safety administrator, then the HACCP administrator, the label administrator, the OSHA administrator. Are you with me? When a person can't put in a garden and use their own domestic kitchen to make some food to sell to the neighbor next door, that is an absolute cultural denial of a whosoever will participatory food culture. And I think that we in the faith community should use that kind of language to the folks who think there's nothing better than another bureaucrat intervening in the marketplace between two neighbors who want to do commerce with each other. When you have the government industrial complex orthodoxy defining and sanctioning what's okay to eat, I say when the government gets between my lips and my throat, that's an invasion of privacy. And when they decide what I can and cannot eat, suddenly you have all sorts of squirrely things like raw milk is hazardous and Mountain Dew and Coca-Cola are safe. And it's not about food safety. It's about access to the market. You can go out and shoot a deer on a 70-degree November day, drag it a mile through the squirrel dung and the sticks and the rocks, parade it prominently on the front end of your blazer around town in the afternoon blazing sun, string it up for a week, hang it in the backyard, and then butcher it out and feed it to your children. And you're a great American hunter. But if you dress one chicken at the appropriate time and sell it to a neighbor, you're suddenly a criminal. Now, you can give the chicken away. That's very benevolent. But if you exchange money, you've suddenly become a criminal. What is it about the exchange of money that suddenly turned it from a benevolent act to a hazardous substance? And just so you know, I am a believer in complete free drugs. I mean, all legalization of all drugs, all of them. Because the government can tell you what you can smoke or shoot up, can also tell you what you can't eat. And it makes my great aunts roll over in their grave. They were members of the Women's Temperance Union back in the early days that brought prohibition. And nothing created. Yeah, this is why Christians in the faith community, we have to be really careful about what we get righteously indignant about. Because sometimes we end up tripping up ourselves, like prohibition, which for all time gave legal precedent for the government to decide what we can and cannot eat. So the answer to food deserts is not bringing in food from outside from food banks. You can't food bank your way into food security. The answer for food deserts is to free up the entrepreneurial capacity in these food desert areas to extend their food production and commerce into their communities so that they bring themselves up from the bottom up instead of the top down and outside in. The problem is that when you have the government intervening in these embryonic innovative startups, you shut down innovation. And that's the biggest tragedy in culture is, you know, it's one thing for the government to require a $1,000 thermometer if you're going to make charcuterie by the tractor trailer load. But if you're going to If you're going to do some experimentation with little kitchen batches of charcuterie to see if there's a market, if you like it, if your recipes are good, if your neighbors want to buy it, buying a $1,000 thermometer is prohibitive. And this is the tragedy in America today. We have a nascent, pent-up, just quivering desire for entrepreneurism that is marginalized, demonized, and criminalized by a host of regulators, like the Declaration of Independence says, the King George has sent to our shores swarms of investigators to eat out our substance and harass our people. And that's what we've got today that is keeping innovation down. Look, our farm, we've checked our chicken manure and it doesn't even have Listeria, Campylobacter, or E. coli in it. Avian influenza, all it takes is two blades of fresh grass a day. Chickens don't get high path avian influenza. We've got the answers for all this stuff. But instead of the culture embracing it and saying, wow, this should be the new standard, I mean, we had our chickens empirically tested for bacterial contamination. We averaged 133 CFU, colony-forming units per milliliter to the second permutation. I've already told you more than I understand about it. But the U.S. DAW stamp-sanctioned 40 chlorine-bathed chickens in the supermarket averaged 3,600 CFU per mil to the second. We know how to make clean food, safe food. But what happens is the regulations are scale prejudicial to small operations and discriminatory to small operations who can't stand all the infrastructure, paperwork, overhead requirements, and they inadvertently concessionize the big operators in the status quo. And that then translates down to very expensive local food and makes us look like a bunch of elitists. When actually it has nothing to do with cost or price, all it has to do is with the prejudicial, discriminatory, scale prejudicial elements of market intervention by the government. Okay, how am I doing? Another 5 minutes. Okay. How about a food and farming system that illustrates faith? You see, what I want to do is I want people to come to the farm and I want them to leave saying, oh, we've just seen forgiveness, faith, relationships, abundance, grace. Are you with me? Yeah, are you? Object lessons. You're with me. Okay. So what about faith? You know, faith is believing in something you can't see. Well, let me tell you something. There is a huge invisible world around us. You know, we have an electron microscope today. And if you look through that viewfinder, pull up a little handful of soil, put it in your viewfinder, electron microscope, peer into that thing, and you're going to see a four-legged cow-looking thing, you know, coming kind of, you know, walking across there, you know. He's grazing on some paramecium and some cilia, you know, and he's you know, slobbering around, saliva, you know. All of a sudden, in from 2 o'clock comes a six-legged, spear-headed, narwhal-looking thing that impales the size of the, you know, and goes, you know, sucks out all that aqueous stuff, you know, and slurps it up, and before the boop can fall down, or down or up, or you know, however he falls, in the soil or falling all sorts of ways. Here comes from 8 o'clock, using military things here, comes this 10-legged centipede-looking thing with scissors on his head. You know, he comes up and whap and knocks the head off the bloop thing, you know, and you know, eats it all up. And I mean, this all happens in like, you know, half a second. You're looking in a viewfinder. Wow, I mean, this makes Steven Spielberg look like a kindergartner. And all this community of beings is happening right here. In fact, MIT says you and I are only 15% human. Did you know that you have 3 microbes on every cell of your body? There are more beings in one double handful of healthy soil than there are people on the planet. A little plant like this, is this real? I don't know. can have, are you ready for this? 100,000 miles of mycelium, root hairs, out. And there's this whole economy, and the plant's bringing in carbon dioxide. It's breaking off the carbon, turning it into polysaccharides, and it's trading sugar to the bacteria, and they're bringing in minerals. And there's these millions and millions of hair-like single microbe things are having their farmers markets, schools, you know, they're doing conferences. Oh, they probably got even a Democrat Libertarian Party down there. And they got all sorts of things going on in the soil. And in our gut, we have 3 trillion of these in our insides. Digesting what we just ate. This is not a sterile place. It's a place of magnificent, awesome, unbelievable being activity with sentient understanding of how to live. And it's invisible to our naked eyes. We didn't even know it existed until the microscope. And yet, when's the last time you heard of a person going into the banker to get a loan for a new business, and the banker, who is completely enthralled by this business idea, he sits back. Well, this is quite a business plan. Best one I've seen in years. In fact, I think you're going to be a millionaire. In fact, I want to be your partner. We're going to be multi-millionaires together, but before I give you the $500,000 to start this business, I got a question. What's this going to do to the earthworms in your community? What's this going to do to the mycelium and the azobacter bacteria? Have you ever heard that? And yet, gentle people, I'm telling you that this invisible world is far more relevant and important in our lives than whether the Dow Jones goes up and down. And yet we don't think about it. Who thought about that world in the shower today? You see, faith, if you don't think about it, if you don't think about the invisible, I'm suggesting that we need to think about the microbial community and their health and our internal gut and the soil development and whether the actinomycetes are happy today and the earthworms are copulating today. That's important. It's just as important, and it is an object lesson of training ourselves to appreciate that the visible is completely and utterly dependent on the invisible. And that the invisible world is more real and more powerful and more profound than the world that we see. So we have this idea in our culture, you know, the germ theory, antimicrobial soap. We got to kill all these things. Rather than understanding that there are way more good ones than bad ones. You know, we have this idea that the earth is some reluctant, mean, evil-intentioned creation, and we have to wrestle, and I'm going to make you, and I'm going to control, and I'm going to make you. When actually, the earth is an abundant manifestation of provision and sufficiency from a benevolent creator and wants to come along as a benevolent partner of abundance and plenty that we caress and massage as a lover. Not abuse as a conquistador rapist. And the story of human civilization, more often than not, is one that entails a conquistador mentality and one of, I mean, the U.S. now has 700 dead zones of riparian areas. We did that. We've depleted the aquifers in the Midwest. What is the answer? Is the answer to withdraw from the environment? Oh, we dare not touch it. What I call environmentalism by abandonment. So the only thing we can do with integrity with the environment is to lock it up in a state park, a wilderness area, you know, some sort of a special green zone where nobody can go? Or is it to use our intellectual mechanical ability and our hands as extensions of redemptive capacity from our benevolent creator and extend redemptive healing to our landscape rather than hurt? Actually building relationships so that we have environmentalism by what I call participation rather than environmentalism by abandonment. How do we do that? Well, 600 years ago, we now know that as much as 10% of the American land base, it wasn't America back then, but 600 years ago, 10% of the land base of what we call the U.S. now was under beaver ponds. Beaver ponds. Boy, imagine if wetland EPA had been around then. But what can we do now? We have intellectual and mechanical ability. So what do? Just farm out those rich terraced beaver pond silt bed loams, you know, and just farm them out until it's all infertile? Or use the petroleum bonanza, a gift of at a tipping point in human history when we were desperate for land healing, the Dust Bowl, and we discovered, you know, all of the U.S., Australia, New Zealand was settled, and we cut all the trees in New Zealand, and everything was going south. What if, instead of embracing chemicals and a mechanical approach to life, what if instead we had used our mechanical and intellectual capacity to start massively biomass regeneration through composting and chipping and use landscapers to develop ponds in highlands like the permaculturalists to rehydrate the landscape even better than the beaver ponds and to actually build soil faster than the buffalo and the prairies and to actually go to a carbon-centric carbon sequestration system, we would have not only fed the planet, we would have done it without three-legged salamanders, infertile frogs, and dead zones the size of New Jersey and the Gulf of Mexico. You see, we didn't have a Manhattan Project for compost. It's almost as if we have a hubris love affair with 10-10-10 chemical. Look what I did. I am clever. I can outsmart nature. God's patterns don't matter. And we're in love with our own intellectual capacity. As if a bag of 10-10-10 is more sexy than a compost pile. I would suggest that a compost pile has way more sex going on it than a bag of 10-10-10. But finally, and I'll close with this. What about a farm food system that exudes sacrifice? The idea of sacrifice, that out of death comes life. Is there anything more precious to the faith community than the fact that Jesus conquered death, that our faith conquered death, that our Savior is not in the tomb, that if we are going to live forever, we must die daily. We must die to ourselves and accept a sacrificial atonement for us. That is precious, and we see that in life all around us. You know, to the animal welfare, the militant vegans and the vegetarians who say, come on, haven't we really gotten beyond, you know, eating animals and that sort of thing? I look at them and I just say, listen, folks, everything is eating and being eaten. If you don't believe it, go lie naked in your flower bed for 3 days and see what gets eaten. And perhaps one of the most profound refreshers of the sanctity of life and the preciousness of life eternal is that on this planet, in order for something to live, something has to die. And we express our most profound glory as humans when we die to one another in community. in servitude to each other. Well, they say, well, but sentient animals are different than plants. Well, I beg to differ. We now know that plants exude phytochemicals to make their leaves bitter so that when herbivores are grazing, the plants secrete phytochemicals that make bitterness to protect themselves from the from too much from being too overly succulent for the animals to eat. I call that pretty sentient. How about maple trees? You know, when the wind blows, the maple trees quit flowing. Why? Because the sap is the maple tree's blood. And the tree, when the wind blows, is afraid that it might lose a branch, which would be a big major break that it would have to send sap to for healing of the wound. So it shuts off the little borehole in the trunk and says, I'm not going to send anything to you. I'm waiting for a big break. When the wind stops, no order breaking, I'll start the sap up again. If that's not sentient, I don't know what is. And now every time we look around today, we're seeing more and more understanding of that this God-made awesome design is way beyond our capacity to understand. And so I think that it would behoove us, instead of walking around into this awesome, mysterious, God-created place like a bunch of swashbuckling sailors that own the place, if we would come humbly, protectively, nurturing. When things die for us to live, we create sacredness in the sacrifice by honoring the life while it's living. And when we view the life while it's living as just inanimate, we can do whatever we want to, confine them in a house, shoot them up with drugs, give them a bunch of GMO grains or whatever, when we view them as mechanical things, we cheapen the sacrifice. And I suggest that when the faith community begins embracing these concepts and conversing with our neighbors to bring a visceral, practical manifestation of our theology into our daily walk, daily thought process, we will see testimonial equity. What we would say on the street, our Christian street cred would gain exponentially in our community as we become the stewards of a creation that's bigger and grander than we can even imagine. And we get to participate as God's hands and feet in this great choreographed object lesson of His glory. Now may all of your carrots grow long and straight. May your radishes be large and not pithy. May tomato blossom end rot affect your Monsanto neighbor's tomatoes. May the coyotes be struck blind at your pastured chickens. May the rain fall gently on your fields, the wind be always at your back, your children rise and call you blessed. And may we, as stewards, leave a legacy of an abundant nest beyond what we inherited. Thank you so much for letting me visit with you.
Good job. Congratulations. Thank you. We're going to do some Q&A about 5-10 minutes, okay? Have a seat. Thank you, Joel. We have some questions, microphones for questions that are lined up where they always are, right there in the middle and over on the side. So we have some time for questions. I'll take the first one or two questions. We don't have that much time, but we talked a little bit about organic farming, and one of the things you mentioned a little bit in your talk, one of the critiques of organic food is that it's really expensive, and so it's kind of elitist. You know, it's great if you're upper middle class, you know, suburban, some of like the hipsters who were on stage last night, That's great for them, but what about the average person? They can't afford to go to, I think you call it Whole Paycheck instead of Whole Foods.
careful, they were up on the board back here.
They're friends of ours. We like them. So
Bunch of commie pinkos.
So what is it? So to explain, how, what would you say to someone who says, look, that's great, you're an organic farmer for the upper middle class, but you're not going to feed the world, you're not going to feed poor people with that. Explain why is there such a price differential between organic and what would be called conventional food?
Well, there are a number of reasons. I mean, I would say the number one reason is because, as I alluded to, the federal government or the government oversight of food safety laws are very scale prejudicial. So that when you have to have the paperwork and infrastructure required for doing 1 pound, the same as you need for 5,000 pounds, it creates an inordinate price pressure on the smaller operation. So that's number one. Number two is that whenever somebody says they can't afford our food, I grab them, I say, all right, take me to your house, and here's what we're not gonna find at your house. We're not gonna find soda, coffee, tobacco, Netflix, widescreen TVs, iPads, iPods, lottery tickets, takeout, you know, heat and eat, hot spots, DiGiorno's frozen pizza, you know, and we're not gonna find People Magazine. The fact is, folks.
You've been to my house.
The fact is, folks, we spend a lot of money on things we don't need to spend, including poor people. I mean, poor people spend a lot of money on things that they don't need.
Not us on poor people, yeah.
Yeah, right. And so, listen. There are poor people, but the fact is that if all the people, look, you can buy a 50-pound bag of oats for 10 bucks and eat oatmeal. You know, the movie Food Inc., if you saw it, you know, it has one really big weakness where the family, you know, says they can't afford good food. And what they do, they stop at Burger King and get this, you know, $10 meal. Let me tell you something. You can buy 2 whole pounds of our world-class grass-finished beef for $10, and there's way more nutrition in a 1/4 pound of that than there is in a bite of that whole fluffy Burger King fecal soup, whatever it is. So it's not what we're spending. Do we really need a Las Vegas? Do we need a Hollywood? Do we need lotteries, state lotteries? I mean, think of the billions of dollars spent that don't need to be, I mean, $100 designer jeans with holes already in the knees. You know, we don't need this stuff. And I'm not seeing any of that stuff as evil. I'm just saying, let's keep the perspective right. And the third thing I would say is that the way to drop the price is to buy volume at a time. Ultimately, you cannot have an integrity food system that's not home-centric any more than you can have a faith system that's not home-centric. So I wish I could snap my fingers and say, we're all gonna eat like kings and it's all gonna be, you know, available and cheap and all that stuff. And nobody has to change anything that they're doing. But the truth is, if you're going to have an integrity economic enterprise of anything, it requires visceral participation in the patrons. And there's nothing as ubiquitous in economic sectors as food. I mean, you can even go naked if you want to, but you can't go without food, unless you're a breatharian.
Breatharians. There's not many of those, so we're not gonna factor that in. Okay, so one other question, and I think one thing you would also explain to me is that the amount of regulations actually raise the price of organic, you said, and the subsidies artificially lower, so there's it's not as clear. The question I have
we externalize the costs. I mean, we live in a funny country, you know, that measures gross domestic product, and it's hilarious. If you pollute a stream, the cost of cleaning up the stream is viewed as a national asset in GDP. Is that crazy? I mean, if you have dysfunctional families and you have to build more juvenile detention centers, that's an asset to the culture in GDP. That's nuts. We don't have an accounting system that accounts for the real value of the commons. So if you rape the commons, that's if you rape the commons, it's considered GDP. And if you have to fix the raped commons, that's also helpful to the GDP. I mean, it's nuts.
So I have one more, and you have to give a short answer because I have a couple of people over here who want to ask questions. And that is the I heard an interview. It's interesting. The CEO, a former CEO of Cargill, named Greg Page, was in an interview, and he said, he was asked, "Do you need GMOs to feed the world?" And this is the CEO of Cargill. He says, "No, you don't. You can feed the world without GMOs." So this kind of, I don't want to get into that debate. He said something interesting. He said, "But if you don't use GMOs, then you're going to have land pollution and water pollution." And you seem to be saying something a little different. You seem to be saying that this type of biomimicry reduces pollution. So how would you answer that point? So again, not just the question of does the use of GMOs require, is it required so that we can preserve the land?
No.
Okay, and that's the next question. No.
Look, you have to understand that, you know, I think it was Upton Sinclair, you know, that commie Upton Sinclair, who said that it's really hard to get a person to believe something when his paycheck depends on believing something else. And so the whole fraud of we're running out of food is the biggest fraud perpetrated on the world population you've ever seen. The world has never been more awash in food than it is today. Never in our history have we thrown away 50% of the human edible food on the planet. Never. We are awash in food, but that is the paranoia that the industry throws to try to make people paranoid, so that, you know, the sky is falling, henny penny, and they'll embrace their brand of production, which is extremely land debilitating, and no, I'm saying that there is actually a symbiosis between multi-species, symbiotic, relationally centric, carbon centric, in situ, solar driven farming that actually is far more productive per acre and builds soil at the same time and hydrates the landscape. But it's a completely different paradigm. And people like this executive doesn't even know we exist. He doesn't even know, I mean, he's in his myopic world, and he doesn't even know, he hasn't been to our farm. He doesn't know that we exist. That's the truth. You know, people ask, well, if it's so easy, why didn't everybody do it? Well, let me tell you something. If the Secret Service Roman soldiers who saw the resurrection would take money to say it wasn't real, then everything is for sale.
Yes, sir.
Sure. Yeah, the whole GMO thing is quite profound. You know, it took 14 years to actually link DDT to infertile frogs and eagle eggs that wouldn't hatch. It took 14 years. We've had GMOs now 16, and we are seeing just an exponential proliferation of studies around the world that are showing everything from autism to abortion to food allergies. Just saw another one. Look, when you start messing with this, remember this microbial community I was talking about, out there, their cousins live in here. And you can't practice microbicide and manipulation to that extent without great big ramifications. And So, A, we don't need GMOs at all. In fact, now we know that they don't produce any more food than the regular. B, GMOs were developed, the whole idea of patenting life. I mean, you know, we decided it wasn't good to own humans back at the Civil War. Maybe that's not a good idea. Now we've decided to even be worse and own the genetic code of life itself, as if it's some sort of a human invention. So the Supreme Court ruling that opened up patenting life as if it's some sort of machine sent us down an incredibly slippery path toward life ownership, you know, a la the Matrix. Okay? So the GMO issue, here it is to me as a libertarian. Here's my answer to the GMO. Instead of outlawing GMOs, I don't understand why the conservative community hasn't been out there jumping up and down on property trespass. GMO is a life form that nature could never produce. I mean, it's not Mendel's peas. Mendel's peas were peas on peas. It wasn't peas on tomatoes, on salmon, on pigs. You know, I mean, if you look in your garden and you see a pig getting it on with a tomato plant, you'd say, that's weird. God has instituted a lot of boundaries to make sure that GMOs can't happen. But in our conquistador swashbuckling hubris, we have waded through that barrier, and we've created beings that have never been here before. Beings, by the way, that are, by definition, highly promiscuous. We live in such a crazy country right now that when you're GMO, and I don't know if you have GMOs, but when your owned beings come across my fence and create promiscuous goings on and give me beings that I don't want, not only can I not sue you for trespass, I have to pay you a penalty for the privilege of your beings coming over and messing with my stuff. And where the conservative community is on property, on trespass on this, I can't wrap my heads around it. And everywhere I go in my liberal, you know, sustainable ag, you know, circles, they're all, we got to outlaw these GMOs, and they throw me under the bus because I don't want to outlaw them. I say, no. They can experiment with them, but if one comes on my property, they're liable. See, that would shut it down by default. Suddenly, then, we would control it not by an agency regulatorily. We would control it by honoring private ownership and stewardship of my stuff. And that creates a much higher moral road from which to deal with it than the regulatory issue.
Fast answers. Ready? Fast answers. Okay, we have time for two super, super fast questions. Go.
Yeah, I'm a 12th generation. I'm sorry.
No, that's right. Yep, start.
I'm a pastor, 12th generation, Virginia, and I just want to thank you tonight for giving such an amazing talk. I worked for 5 years at a natural food store in Richmond, and at that time I realized that my atheist pagan friends had a higher value than I did for food and creation. Tonight you said glory is a word that honors the distinctiveness of something. How does the church regain a right view of our planet, seeing the reality of God's glory and that which is distinct?
Fast.
I think the church regains the high moral ground in this, you know, the creation stewardship high moral ground. The church regains it when we begin actively having these conversations of whether to have styrofoam or paper or wash the dishes, or whether to take the big church lawn and turn it into community gardens, or whether to take the young people, instead of taking them to a theme park, how about putting mattocks in their hands, sending them out to a farmer friend that has thistles and multiflora rose, and having them learn how to tangle with sin as an object lesson of brambles, and come home with stickered up and realize, man, I'm going to fight sin. That's a good object lesson. I mean, why can't we do that with our young people? You know, but if you do anything in most of our churches regarding farming, you've just lowered the socioeconomic, you know, status of the church because, you know, brown people and intellectually disadvantaged people farm. We have potlucks with Chick-fil-A dinners.
One more. Dr. Bruce.
So I'm with you. I live in the But didn't he drive seeds 700 miles and inject the ground with nitrogen? This to me sounds like a mechanistic approach. So help me understand, sure. Would you have rejected that work in the 1960s? Or would you say, is there some nuanced way of understanding the distinction that could help me understand how you would embrace that, and yet these other things you would say no?
That is such a sweet question. Okay, wow, you know, I could answer this in half an hour, but I won't. The short answer is that for every what mechanistic industrial panacea for a problem, trust me, there is a creation stewardship honoring counterpart. Okay? For everyone. And the problem is that we have constipation of imagination, you know, and we don't have moral compass, okay, that drives us. So the truth is that Norman Borlaug would not have been necessary at all. And I'm not trying to say he was not an evil man. He was a perfect example of well-intentioned. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, right? It was a perfect example of that. And all of us are in a context. He was in his context, okay? The truth is that the BioFERT program developed right now in the Campesino areas is far more productive than anything that Borlaug brought along, okay? But it took the soil depleting green revolution to bring the BioFERT alternative to pass. And you know, innovation is a product of necessity, right? Right, necessity, mother of invention. So these things are cyclical. You know, this is one reason why, you know, when I say we shouldn't have an EPA, because oh, you hate the environment. No, the fact is that in order to have the cultural will to develop an EPA, we've started having a cultural mentality of maybe, you know, maybe fires burning on our rivers are not a good thing. And so this created a political issue that got to be enough of a majority to create an EPA. The fact is, we would not have solved anything faster and would have eliminated all of the overreaches and regulatory, you know, and things that shut down small businesses and all this and of the EPA had we instead focused our attention on transparency in the marketplace, perhaps even independent certifiers that as consumers we would join with a system of values. You go out and watchdog for me. And we're going to buy from the good guys and not buy from the bad guys. But the idea, you know, my liberal friends, and I have oodles, you know, probably more of them than non. It's incredibly citizen disempowering to assume that the most efficacious solution to any societal problem is a government solution. There are lots of alternative solutions, and it's the same thing with Borlaug. I mean, Albert Howard brought to us compost, you know, from India. That was 1943, okay? But it took a while for chippers and plumbing and electrical motors and conveyors and chainsaws and things to develop so that we could actually efficiently run a biomass-centric system in our population base efficiently, you know, compared to 200 years prior. So societal evolution and innovation evolution occur in context, in time. And the truth is that all of those mechanical inventions, and including eliminating, you know, 2,000 years worth of accumulated cormorant and booby manure on 100-foot deep islands off of Peru from 1820 to 1840 in steamships, you know, to go to Britain and the U.S. for fertilizer. You know, that also was inappropriate. It was an inappropriate solution. And so there are, for every one of these problems, there is an alternate solution. When everybody says, well, the only way to do, I automatically start, you know, backing up when somebody says, the only way, no. The only place there's an only way is a way to heaven. That's the only time there's an only way.
Okay. All right, thank you, Joel, very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all.